Good morning, and welcome to worship at Bryn Mawr United Methodist Church. No matter who you are or how you're watching this video here today, we welcome you as we gather together across the miles from different spaces and places to be, as Scripture says, of one accord in Christ Jesus. As we worship God this morning with all our hearts, all our minds, all our spirits, and all our strength. My name is Pastor Meredith Dodd, and I'm the pastor here at Bryn Mawr. This morning, the theme of our worship has to do with emptying ourselves. What does it mean to empty ourselves, to pour ourselves out like water from a pitcher for the sake of the common good? We'll take a look at one of the earliest hymns in the Bible from the very, very early church and look at this theme of what it means to empty ourselves out for the common good. And now I invite you into a time of prayer as we begin our worship together. We're going to start by praying for the world, both in English and in Spanish. Amen. Let's continue to be in prayer. Will you pray with me? Holy One, it is said that the three best words to pray with are help and thanks and wow. And so this morning, God, as we gather, we think of all of the places in your world that make us say wow. For the beauty of the change of seasons into fall, for laughter, for love, for the delight of something simple like the feeling of cool water running between our fingers every time we wash our hands. This is a world that fills us with awe, God, and we thank you for your generosity in sharing it with us. God, we pray by saying, help. There are places in our hearts and in our world that are hurting, God, that overwhelm us, that seem to inspire some days nothing but helplessness and despair. And so we turn to you. We lift our eyes to you, for it is from you that comes our help. We pray for people we love who are sick and in pain. Give them peace. We pray for people who are mourning and grieving. Give them comfort. We pray for places in the world that are on the brink of great change. We pray for our country, God, facing an election like no other. Give us wisdom. Give us courage. Give us a commitment to love one another as you have loved us. with our voices, and even with our votes. God, we pray, wow. We pray, help. And most of all, we pray, thanks. You bless us in ways that we don't always have words for. But when we slow down and notice, we give thanks. Even in times of great illness and turbulence, all is not lost. There is still so much to say thank you for. For there is no height or depth that can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. And for this, above all other things, God, we give you thanks. And so today, as we remember your Son, Jesus, we pray together the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Happy Sunday, Bryn Mawr. Our reading from Philippians, chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord, and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him, and gave him the name that is above every other name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Amen.
Friends, during the past 7 months, I've developed lots of hobbies. I do puzzles, I go for walks, I play with my children. But the hobby, the activity that I do each and every day without fail, twice a day, is that I cook for my family. So many of our routines have been disrupted by this virus and all of the other things that are happening in our world, but every day at 12:30, we sit down and we eat a lunch together. And every day at 6, we sit down and we eat dinner. And more often than not, they're meals that I have cooked myself. Now, I do this because I like to. I think finding new recipes and trying to make a meal out of what's in the pantry is fun. But I also find that cooking for the people I love every day is one of the ways that I can, in my small way, serve the common good. I can pour myself out into my cooking and nourish the people around me with a healthy and delicious meal and with the kind of sharing and good conversation that comes from sitting around a table with the people you love. Now, my cooking doesn't always go the right way. In fact, there are two main ways that my cooking tends to take a turn for the worse. The first way is when I'm making something on the stove or setting some bread dough to rise, and I can't help but keep looking inside the pot, keep poking at that dough, keep seasoning things to make it taste just a little bit spicier, just a little bit saltier. And it turns out that there are certain recipes where if you disrupt them enough, they won't work anymore. If you let the steam out of a pot of rice, the rice won't cook. If you continue to poke at bread dough while it's rising, it won't rise and the bread won't taste right. If you fuss too much with your cooking, if you try too much to control the outcome of the thing that you're preparing, that thing that you're pouring yourself into will fall flat. The second way that my cooking tends to go wrong is when I do the opposite. It's not that I'm paying too much attention to what I'm cooking. It's that I'm paying too little attention. This happens most often when I have something in the oven and it's supposed to bake for a certain amount of time and I've forgotten to set a timer. So if the thing was supposed to be in the oven for 30 minutes, I'll put it in the oven and I'll get involved in another activity and 60, 90 minutes later, I'll come back to a big cloud of smoke and a charred black mess. If I ignore my cooking, if I assume that everything will be okay, if I just neglect it and move on with my life, I tend to ruin the meal I'm trying to prepare. Friends, all of us, no matter whether we have a big family or we live by ourselves, all of us are at this moment in the world being called, I believe, by God to pour ourselves out in some way to serve the common good. For some of us, that way is cooking for the people that we live with. But it doesn't have to be cooking. There are lots of ways of pouring yourself out for the sake of another person. The Bible gives the example of Jesus doing this when he chose to become a human being. It says Jesus poured himself out not regarding equality with God as something he could exploit, but instead taking the form of a human, of a slave, pouring out the love that he had into the small container of the form of a human being is one of the main ways that Jesus chose to love this world. Friends, when we are listening to God's call to pour ourselves out to serve the common good, it's not always an easy thing to do. There are temptations that we face, that I face, that even Jesus faced. The first of these that we see playing out all over the place right now is the temptation to look out for number one. Sometimes we start out to serve other people and we get distracted by making sure that we serve ourselves first, by using the power that we have to make sure that we have the most, that we are the most, that we feel the most important. And so we engineer our surroundings, even if sometimes it's under the guise of serving others, we engineer things to make ourselves look and feel important. And to this temptation to control things to the point that we are always number one, the Bible says to us to trust that God is at work in you. God is enabling you to will and work for God's good pleasure. When we are facing the temptation to look out for number one and to control everything so that we're okay, Scripture reminds us we need to let go and trust that God is already at work in who we are, in how we love, in how we give our love away. The second temptation that we face when we're trying to pour ourselves out for the common good is the temptation, that second temptation that I face when I'm cooking. It's not to mess with things and control things too tightly. It's to turn away and to let go and to stop thinking and stop caring about the thing, about the person, about the community that we initially set out to serve. We face the temptation in this world of not caring at all. We face the temptation of assuming that there's nothing we can do to change things, that our voice doesn't matter, that our vote doesn't matter, that our work in the world is not big enough to make any kind of real difference at all. And to this temptation, the Bible says this: remember to work out your own salvation, your own healing, with fear and trembling. Each one of us has to figure out our own journey. And it involves fear and trembling because that work is a really big deal. But my friends, when we're figuring out how we are to serve and love one another, to pour ourselves out for the common good, we don't get to skip the hard parts and pretend that this work is not before us. Because friends, the world needs you. And to pretend otherwise is not to be faithful to our calling. Scripture invites us to seek the mind of Christ, the common good, the one love that unites us all, even when we vote for different people, even when differences of opinions have us arguing around our family dinner tables. I don't think God wants us to mess with things too much, to be like a cook who's always lifting the lid of the rice pot so that the rice doesn't actually cook. But neither do I think God wants us to sit back and say, well, there's just nothing I can do. Whatever happens is going to happen. So friends, this week and throughout these coming weeks, I pray that you will pour yourself out, empty yourself for the common good, emptying yourself out of all of the love that God has given you for this world. I pray that you will do this freely, that you'll do it willingly, that you'll do it even joyfully, even when there's a cost, maybe especially even when there's a cost. And as you pour yourself out, may you trust that even when you are afraid, even when you are trembling, even when you are not sure what the next step toward your salvation and healing is going to be, may you trust that God is still at work in you and through you and around you, for God's good pleasure, yes, but for yours, and most of all, for the common good of everything that God has created. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, receive now these words of blessing. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rains fall softly into your life. And friends, until we meet again, may you be held gently, tenderly, always in the palm of God's hand. Amen.